Unmuting the band.
give Jesus a shout of praise, church. You excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning? And he is risen. Amen. We're so excited you came to Mountain City today. I want to invite you to continue worshiping with us this morning and celebrate our resurrected King. Good you are to us.
stars, they wear the morning sun is dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon him. Son of God was laid in darkness, a battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake, the stone was rolled away, his perfect love could not. We'll be right back.
others, he cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross that we may see and believe. Those who were crucified with him also reviled him. And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? And some of the bystanders hearing it said, behold, he is calling Elijah. And someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink, saying, wait, let us see whether Elijah will come and take him down. And Jesus uttered a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, truly, this man was the Son of God.
Continue to worship with the Lord this morning with the giving of our tithes and offerings, and then we're going to worship him by hearing a message from his word. So ushers, if you would, please make your way to the end of each aisle and While they do that, church family, thank you for being here. I hope that you remember, like, we're celebrating because of, I can't watch that without crying. I've watched it like two or three times, and each time I cry every time. It's so crazy to think about what he went through to save you and me. But he rose, and that is why we are celebrating today. If you're a guest here with us, welcome. We're so glad that you came to join us. I hope that you grabbed one of these bulletins on the way in. If not, let ushers know. They'll give you one. There's some ministries in here that are applicable to every stage of life. We also have events that are coming up that you might be interested in attending. Also, if you would, if you're new here, there's a connection center in the lobby. It says, because I was invited to go there, there's a gift for you. We would just love to connect with you. Well, if you guys don't mind, I'd like to take a moment just to pray. Pray for our offering, pray for the sermon, just pray for today and praise Jesus for what we're taking time to remember. So please join me as we take a moment to pray. God, we thank you so much. God, we are here to worship you. We get to worship you every day because of what you did. You died for us, but you rose again. God, thank you so much for doing that. And God, I pray as we worship you today, you really would be glorified, that we'd be focusing on you. We'd be focusing on the right things, and it's you, Jesus. So God, I pray that right now as we take a moment to worship you with the giving our tithes and offerings, I pray that it would be genuine worship. We would just give back to you freely what you gave to us. And God, I pray that as our pastor brings the word of God to us, I pray that we would listen attentively. I pray for him. I pray that you'd give him clarity of speech and conviction and boldness to preach your word powerfully. I pray that you'd anoint him to do so. And please help us pay attention and feed our souls. God, change us. God, if someone came in here today and they don't know you, save them today. God, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Guess what day it is? Guess what day it is? Huh? Anybody? Kevin. You ready for this?
Ready for what?
Kev. Today. You know. Guess what day it is? Brian. You know what day it is? Brian. I know you can hear me. Barista. What you doing?
Making coffee.
Yeah, you are. And you know what day it is. Run. Run. What day is it, Ronnie? You know what day it is.
Yeah, it's church day.
Yes, it is. Church day.
I don't know what's funnier, him dropping my table or... I'll tell you what, our creative team is amazing. It is church day. It is a day to celebrate the resurrection, amen? And I'll tell you what, I am so excited that you are here today. We have two incredible services. We know that God is working even amidst the snow. What in the world? Oh, my son and daughter are down in North Carolina. They showed us this beautiful sunrise service, and I went, yeah, we don't have that. We don't have that. Well, again, I want to thank you. If you're a guest here today, we're honored that you would spend your Easter with us. Today, we're talking about the elephant in the room. And, you know, historically, Easter is one of those times that is the most attended time in all of the year. This is the time when everybody comes to church. I don't know who's here for the first time or who hasn't been here for a while. But again, we're glad that you are here. And we're going to do this series on the elephant in the room. Now, you may think, what in the world does that have to do with Easter? We're going to talk about that in just a minute. But the Elephant in the Room series that we're doing over the next few weeks is about those really, really awkward, weird topics that nobody really wants to talk about. Nobody really wants to discuss them outside of church, let alone in the doors of the church, and let alone from a biblical perspective. So we hope that you'll come for the next few weeks and just engage with us. Give us a few weeks. Don't just come to Easter and then go amongst your way. We hope that this series will entice you into staying a few more weeks as we build relationships with Christ. But have you ever had the elephant in the room moment in your family? Have you ever had that moment where you come home and you realize, hey, there's this big thing that nobody really wants to deal with. Everybody's trying to sweep it under the rug. You know that elephant in the room. So for some of you, it's Christmas time and politics get brought up. That's the elephant. Nobody really wants to go there, right? We know that there's the one guy in the family that's on the other side. And we got to kind of like be nice, but not, right? It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter what side you're on. There's always something like that. How about when you go home and you realize that there's one sibling that has just totally made a wreck of their lives and nobody wants to talk about it? We're just not going to bring it up. But we know it needs to be brought up because the truth is it needs to be talked about. How about the one where, you know there's a marriage that's struggling, but they're just on Facebook. They look so pretty and everything's wonderful. And you meet them and you're like, you're such liars. Can we just deal with the elephant in the room? I mean, let's be real. How about when you go out and you realize some relative you have has kids that are just crazy. They're out of control. There's nothing, and they think their kids are angels. And you're like, listen, you just burnt down the entire store and the restaurant. I don't think your kids are angels. You know, the elephant in the room. In this day and age, the elephant can be anything. I mean, it can be vaccinated or non-vaccinated. This could be the elephant in the room. Nobody wants to talk about it. Realize this. The elephant is one of those things that always cause trouble. Well, in Easter time, just so you know, over the centuries, there's been lots of elephants in the room. Over Easter, it's incredible to think about. As a matter of fact, if we really wanted to sit down and really talk about it, there's probably even a few in this room right here would agree there's some elephants in the room. There's this elephant in the room, like, how do we deal with this thing about Easter candy? I don't see that in the Bible. Like, is it a celebration of the resurrection, or is it some kind of a pagan ritual of honoring the gods, or maybe the Easter egg? You know what it is. It's like, I think the egg is kind of like about worshiping like these fertility gods. It's not really about Easter, but some people say, oh no, it's a picture of the celebration and then the new life found in Christ. How about the Easter bunny? Just so you know, the Easter bunny. It's been a problem in Easter for years. It's like, where did that come from? That's the dumbest thing ever. And yet some people would think, hey, it's fine. It's fine. It's not about pagan religions. Again, we can twist it into something about modern new life or however you want to do it. One of the biggest elephants in the room over the centuries, just so you know, is just the day Easter was chosen to be on. I mean, there's been countless arguments about when should we celebrate Easter and how do we know the real day and how does that all work? The truth is, it really ultimately doesn't matter. The reality for some is that, or for most, we have this idea of the elephant in the room that there's been some paganism drafted into this idea of the celebration of the resurrection. It's unfortunate. But the truth is this. Do you realize that there is nothing in the Bible that indicates that the modern church celebrated Easter or Christmas at all? Do you realize that? There's nothing there. You can't find a verse that says, and they met together, they celebrated the resurrection. No, they celebrated the resurrection every single day. It was a new life that they had. This is what it was. And the bottom line that we find ourselves is this resurrection that we celebrate is not about bunnies and about eggs. How many of you guys have done your eggs already? Raise your hand. It's okay. All the kids in the house, that's awesome. Grandpa and the grandkids, we did our eggs yesterday. We'll hide them today and it'll be wonderful. But the truth is, we don't celebrate Easter because of eggs and bunnies and candy. We don't celebrate Easter because it's just another church service. No, we celebrate Easter because of one thing, and it is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It is our time to acknowledge and to remind ourselves that he rose from the grave. What was Easter, this celebration all about? It was about the power over death. That's what he did. His power over death, his worthiness to be worshiped like we just did. His great love for us, his sacrifice. How about his making a way for us to have eternal life? Is that not worth celebrating, church? Amen. It is. You see, all of these are great things, but I really believe there's an elephant in the room that the modern church is running from. I really truly believe that. There's one thing that the resurrection is all about, but everyone wants to ignore it. You won't hear it preached very often anymore in churches. Matter of fact, it will be reclassified and changed in so many ways. This elephant is an awkward moment. When I say elephant again, what do I mean by elephant in the room? Well, this is what I mean. Something that is true, but it's uncomfortable to talk about. It triggers an awkward feeling inside. Sometimes people are annoyed that you even brought it up, or they're irritated. Some get flat out angry. Man, others try to take the Bible and twist what it is so that they can avoid the conflict of it. Some even reject the idea altogether and just say, listen, we're not even going to talk about it because it's not real. It's almost like they stick their fingers in their ears and go, la, 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 I can't hear you. This is what I mean by elephant in the room. You see, many people don't want to face the elephant because they don't know how to handle the truth. They don't know how to handle a topic that just makes the hair on the back of their neck climb up. So what is the elephant today that is so many churches are missing? So many churches are denying. So many churches don't understand that this elephant has everything to do with this incredible resurrection. What is it? It's this elephant in the room called hell. Yeah, I said those words in church out loud. Some of you are like, what's the big deal? Well, let me tell you what the big deal is. Throughout history, hell is real, has been an issue, has been a topic that has caused conflict, but no greater time than right now in history. Do you realize churches have redefined hell? They're making hell everything up that they can. They're trying to say, well, it's the love of God and we've got to avoid this topic called hell. I mean, what is hell all about? What is hell all about? Why are they avoiding it? Why don't they want to talk about it? Why don't we want to talk about it? Jesus said a lot about hell, just so you know. Do you realize that? Now, I just got really quiet in the room, so it's okay. What does hell have to do with the resurrection, and why did Jesus talk about it so much? What is the big deal? Do you realize we say we're set free, 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 free from what? Death and hell. This is where we're free from. We have to ask ourselves, what are we really been freed from? What is it that we really want to talk about? This elephant, again, is so awkward. Everybody in the room is going, I don't know what to say. Let's just see what Jesus said about hell. It's a place of eternal torment for the unbelieving. Man, that's difficult. Matthew 25, 46 says this, and these, the unbelieving, will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Hell is a place where the fire never burns out. Mark chapter 9, verse 43. And if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life crippled than with two hands and go to this hell of this unquenchable fire. Hell is a place, not only of that, of absent of anything good. Hell is a place created for the devil and his angels. Matthew chapter 25, verse 41 says this. Then he, Jesus, will say to those on his left, depart from me, you accursed, into eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Hell is a place few want to talk about, and yet Jesus spoke about hell more than anyone else in the Bible. Let's not call him a hell, fire, and brimstone preacher, but he kind of would set the tone. And that's not what I'm going to do here today. Why did he talk about hell so much? He talked about hell so much because the resurrection, listen, the resurrection is all about him making a way for you to be forgiven and given a chance to avoid this awful place called hell. This place of hell is true. This movement to avoid hell or take hell out of the world is an awkward thing, but it is a lie. Dealing with hell and the reality of it is hard. I just want you to know something. Having this conversation with you today is difficult. I don't like talking about hell. I know you don't like talking about hell because hell is awkward. Hell is awkward. It's the elephant in the room. It's the thing nobody really wants to say. I mean, think about these questions. This is what I get all the time, and I'm sure you do too. And how could a loving God send people to hell? That's a tough question. How about this one? How could a forgiving God be so unforgiving? I mean, if this celebration is all about this incredible resurrection and life and hope, how do we deal with this elephant? Man, how about this one? How could your God be so loving and send people who've never heard the gospel to hell? This is tough. We don't like this question. Man, hell is a cruel and excessive punishment. Why would God ever allow it to exist? Again, I want you to know something. I struggle with these questions. It's not that I don't know the answers. I'm just letting you know I struggle with these questions. These questions are hard to answer, so let's talk about them. Let's talk about them. Let's talk about the elephant in the room. I have chosen Easter on purpose to talk about this topic because I thought there'd be no greater awkward moment than now. The elephant in the room. This is how we launch the series. Hell is described in three ways, in the Bible. Three ways. Three words are used. Gehenna. It's originally referred to as the Valley of Hinnom, a place believed to be accursed because it was a place where child sacrifice had happened. Later, it's referred to as a place of suffering for the damned. Jesus describes the word as a place of eternal suffering that we read earlier in Matthew chapter 10 and verse 28. This word right here for hell is Gehenna. It says this in 28. And do not fear those who cure the body and cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both body and soul in hell, Gehenna, this place. This is what Jesus is referring to, this word. Some will say, hey, how about this one? Mark 9:43. And if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter and cripple and two hands than to go to hell, Gehenna, this one, with the unquenchable fire. See, Jesus talked about this, and he's like, hey, there's this word. He used the word. They knew the word. There was another word called Sheol. Sheol is a reference to the grave, the realm of the dead. Psalms 89, verse 48 says this, what man can live and never see death? That's none of us. Who can be delivered? Who can deliver his soul from the power of Sheol? Hades is another Greek word that we'll see in the Bible. The word means the underworld. Revelations 1:18 says this, and I, Jesus, died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys to death and Hades, this place called hell. We also need to understand the Bible talks about hell this way. It says this, that there will be a great lake of fire at the end of days, a place where we will cast death and hell into it. Jesus said this in Matthew 25 and verse 41. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you accursed, into eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. We're going to talk about that in a minute. Revelations 20:10 says this, and the devil who had deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur where the beast and the false prophet were, and they were tormented day and night forever and ever. This is the lake of fire. So we have these words, Gehenna, Sheol, Hades, hell, the lake of fire, the pit. What is all this about? What is it all about? Why is there such a place called hell? Why is it hard to deal with this elephant in the room? The reality is this. The reason why Christ spoke about hell before his resurrection, he was talking about it all the time in several, many, many parables, is because of this. He knew this, that without faith in him, people would spend eternity in this place. Without faith in him, people would spend eternity in this awkward place, this place of tough torment, torture, punishment, the thing nobody wants to talk about. Revelations 20:14 says this, and death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. People, this is an awkward thing, but it was spoken of. You want to know what's great about Easter? You want to know why I chose today to talk about it? Because Easter is all about conquering hell, sin, death, and hell. This is what it's all about. Acts, if you have your Bibles, chapter 2 and verse 30. Luke writes this, right, talking back about a prophecy that David had said. Here, look at this, Acts chapter 2 and verse 30. King David, this is Luke talking. Being therefore a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne. Okay, this is David. David said, listen, there'll be a day when there'll be another descendant on my throne. He foresaw and spoke of the what? The resurrection of Christ. The resurrection of Christ, a prophecy. Thousands of years before Jesus said, hey, there'll be one, the Son of God who will come. He will live a sinless life. And he will resurrect himself. And it says this, and he was not abandoned in Hades. He was not abandoned in hell. Why? Because he arose victorious, nor did his flesh see corruption. Why do we talk about hell? Why is the elephant in the room that we don't want to talk about hell? Why don't we even want to discuss it during the resurrection and Easter? I have no idea. Because this is what it's all about. Christ overcoming sin, death, and hell. Jesus was the overcomer. He was victorious over it. Not only that, we know that hell exists because even in Revelations, John talks about hell. He meets up with Jesus, who's going to discuss end times with him. Notice this, Revelation chapter 1 and verse 17. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. This is John the Revelator talking. But he laid his right hand on me, saying, "Fear not, I am the first and the last, the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. I have the keys to death and Hades." If hell is not real, what are his keys to? The closet? No. No. This resurrection is much more than our celebrating our eternal life. It's a celebration of Christ conquering sin, death, and this ugly world called hell that you and I rarely like to talk about. Listen, faith in his resurrection is the key. When he says the key, what's the key? The key is the faith in his resurrection. We have the keys. We are not held by hell. We are not held by death. We are not held by sin because we have placed our faith in the resurrection. So why should we embrace this elephant in the room called hell? Because hell is real. Listen, if you're here today, I just want you to know something. We can avoid the topic all we want, that it doesn't make it any less true. Hell is real. It is real, real, real. Man, how do we struggle with this? Let's go back to those questions. Let's just address them. Why would a loving God send good people to a place called hell? Now, ask yourself that question. How would you answer that question? How would a good God send good men and women, nice people, to this place called hell? I want you to understand something. The reason why we struggle with hell is because you and I struggle with the reality of the consequence of our sin. We really don't want to see ourselves as who we really are. And I'm not going to point at anybody who's lost. I'm going to talk about me. The reality of my own understanding of hell is the fact that I don't see myself as worthy of it. I think I'm a pretty good guy, and I'm sure you do too. But the reality is this: there is none good compared to Christ's righteousness. None. There's not a person in the room here today that could stand for one millisecond before the righteousness of a holy God. It cannot happen. It's the thing nobody wants to talk about. We want to talk about love and grace, but we don't want to talk about God's holiness. God is holy. He is perfection. He is absolute righteousness. Romans chapter 3 and verse 12 says this: "All have turned aside together. They have become worthless. No one does good, not even one." Not even one. God doesn't send anyone, by the way, to hell. People choose out of their own free will to reject who God is. You need to understand that. Everyone rejects God. No one seeks after him. Romans 5 and verse 12 says this: "Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all have sinned." You and I, we are guilty. Now listen, I want you to understand something. We're not going to hell because Adam sinned. We're going to hell because we have continued in Adam's sin. We have continued to choose that way of life. And this is tough for us to understand. How about this question about what about those who've never heard? Now, this one's hard because we think, oh, man, there's just people who've never heard the gospel. They don't know God. They don't understand. I want you to understand that might not be true. Matter of fact, that's not true. That's not what the Bible says at all. And if you and I were honest with our own selves, we would know in our own lives that we've always known there is a God. We've always known there's a God. There's no way this garbage that these guys are selling us on evolution is true. No one believes that down deep in their heart. How do I know? Because Romans chapter 3, verse 10 says this, it is written, none is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks God. We don't seek him, and then not only that, listen to this, Romans chapter 1, verse 16, let's go back in chapter, two chapters. This is what Paul said. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. Power of God from death and hell, we could say. To everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Verse 17 says this, for it is the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. Notice verse 18, for the wrath of God, we could put the word justice of God. Because of the holiness of God, God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and all unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. This is speaking of all mankind. For what can be known about God is plain to them. For what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them. For the invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world. In the things that have been made, so they are without excuse, verse 20 says. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for the image resembling mortal man, birds, animals, and creeping things. My friend, listen to me. If you're here today, I want you to understand the question. How could God send good people to heaven? There are no good. We are not good compared to his holy righteousness. Number two, how could God send people who've never heard the gospel, the good news about God? God says, listen, I have revealed myself. And anyone who seeks after me in acknowledging of who I am will find me. The Spirit moves upon us. You see, here today, we struggle with this truth. We struggle with this, whether God would do such a thing. How could we understand that? Hell is a place where we can't put our minds around it. We can't grasp it. The truth is this. We also cannot grasp who God is. You see, the whole story of the resurrection, the reason why you're here today is to celebrate the reality that God knew. God knew that man's heart was wicked. God knew it, and so he came to this earth. He lived a sinless life. He humbled himself. He died on a cross. He conquered death and hell. This is what we call the age of grace. Age of grace. When we say God loves you, I want you to understand something. It doesn't mean he loves you and therefore there is no punishment for sin. What it means is God loves you and you can avoid the punishment for sin if you'll just give your life to him. This is the age of grace. We're living in these moments. A just God has every right to wipe us off the face of the earth and end humanity as we know it tomorrow. And there will be, by the way, a judgment day. And who knows when it's coming, but it's not here today because this is the age of grace. Now, I don't know about you, and I don't know when you got saved and how you got saved, but when I was just a young man, a preacher preached on hell. And I want you to know something. That story of hell transformed my life. You want to know why? Because hell is real. And I didn't want to go there. I don't think there's a single person in this room that wants to go to hell. But everybody wants to embrace the resurrection. Not understanding that the resurrection is all about defeating death and hell. And so my answer, my question for you is this. Do you understand this elephant in the room cannot be avoided? We cannot deny what this truth is. We must embrace the fact that hell is real. Now, I'm sure in this room today, there are some who have never given their life to Christ, or some in this room have never understood or couldn't answer this question that I should ask from the very beginning. Is if you know hell is real, if you know the resurrection is real, can you say with certainty that you are 100% sure that you are going to go to heaven? Are you 100% sure? When I was in that church in that moment, as that pastor was talking and describing hell and talking about how awful it was and how wonderful the love of Jesus was, who died for my sin so that I could avoid this terrible place called hell, I had to surrender my life. The Spirit moved upon my soul, and I'll never forget it. I'm on my knees with my mother saying, "Mom, what must I do to be saved?" And we prayed that very moment. And I asked Jesus Christ into my heart. My life has never been the same. From that moment on, have I struggled with my salvation? Absolutely, like many. But the reality is this: I know for a fact that I am going to heaven. I have given my life to Christ. I'm sure many of you in here are the same. Think back to that moment. Think back to that moment when you embraced the love of Christ for the consequence of your sin. If you don't think you were saved from hell and sin and a separation from God, I want you to know something. You're missing out on truly being broken and joyous and thankful in your own faith. But for you in this room who've never given your life to Christ, I want you to understand something. This verse is so amazing. Romans, I love this book. This book is incredible. Jesus not only dies on the cross, not only does he describe hell, not only does he give us this resurrection, but he tells us the way. Now, this is what should be the question everybody has. How come it's so amazingly easy for the lost to become saved? Did everyone do that? Why is it so incredibly easy for the lost to become saved? If you're lost here today and you've never accepted Jesus Christ, let me just explain what I'm saying. I mean, if there's this heaven and there's this hell, if there's this God, and there's this adversary called the devil who's trying to destroy everything about you, why did Jesus make it so easy for you and I to have eternal life, to avoid this awful place called hell? You want to know why? Because he did all the work. What we're celebrating this Easter is that Jesus did all the work. There is nothing we have to do. There is nothing that we can do to receive eternal life. There is nothing that we can do to avoid this place called hell except one thing: confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus Christ. That's it. Believe in our heart that he is risen from the dead. Turn from our old life, worshiping, following someone else, and pursue a life of Christ. Simple. Free. Freeing. Forgiving. A life of hope and purpose and meaning. You see, the reason why Easter is so incredible, the reason why we want to celebrate it with all that we have, is because hell is real, and Jesus conquered it with his life. Conquered it. Think about that. Just take a moment. Ponder the reality. You were once dead in your trespasses and sins, and now you are made alive in Christ through the resurrection of Jesus and the conquering of sin, death, and hell. What a beautiful thing. What a beautiful thing. If you're here today and you're not 100% sure that Jesus Christ is your Savior, if you're not 100% sure that you're going to heaven one day, I'm going to give you an opportunity in just a minute. I'm going to ask you to do something ridiculous. I'm going to ask you to fight against the elephant in the room, which will be, am I willing to stand up and come forward and let the pastor pray and learn about what it means to become a Christian? It's going to be the elephant in the room. It's going to be the hardest thing you've ever done. There's going to be a battle within your soul between the flesh and the spirit. In just a moment, there's no question, those who are not believers in this house today are under conviction because the Spirit is moving right here, right now. And I want you to know we celebrate that moment because we know this, that God loves you and he doesn't want you to go to that awful place called hell. And that's what Easter is all about. So in just a minute, we're going to stand to our feet. And I'm going to ask you, as they play music, if you would come down here and meet with the pastors and give your life to Jesus so that you can be 100% sure you'll avoid this awful place called hell. If you're not 100% sure that you're going to avoid this awful place called hell, I'm asking you, would you please come here? Jesus is waiting for you. Now listen, again, I want you to know something. There is going to be a war. That first step that you're going to have to take, that embarrassing moment that you're going to have to say, excuse me, I need to go forward, is going to stop you. Your pride is going to get in the way. And I'm asking you right now, remove the pride. Because everyone else in the room here today who's a believer is celebrating like the angels in heaven that you would consider Jesus. I just want you to know you're amongst friends here today. So church, let's stand to our feet. Here is the call. If you're here today and you'd like to deal with the elephant in the room called hell, if you would like to avoid that awful place, I'm asking you right now, get out of your seat. Get out of your seat. Come down right here in the front and join me. Every one of you, come on down. I don't care if there is one. I don't care if there is five. I don't care if you're the only guy. I want you to know Jesus died for you. He died for you. He rose for you so that you could have eternal life. So would you please, as they play, join me right here, right now. Jesus is talking to you. Jesus is talking to you. What does it take to be saved? Confessing that Jesus is Lord. Man, I'm so glad just you've come. We are all so excited that you're here. Church, let's celebrate. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you for your love for us. We thank you that you rose from the dead and conquered death and hell. We thank that you've given us a way to have eternal life, that we might know you. Lord, for all those in the house today who did not have the courage to come forward, Lord, I pray that they would pray a simple prayer of confession, declaring that you are God and they are not, trusting in his resurrection from the grave. Lord, I pray for our people. I'll pray for our city that we might be bold in talking about the elephant in the room called hell. In Jesus' precious name, and amen, and amen. Amen. Church, listen, let's give this man a hand. Church, I just want you to know, when one gets saved, all of heaven rejoices. Let me tell you again, when one gets saved, all of heaven rejoices. Do you hear me? Tens and tens and tens and thousands of angels are celebrating the return of one, the reconciliation of one. Church, I'm telling you this, it's the elephant in the room. It's the most awkward topic to talk about at Easter of all time. That's why they gave it to me. And I'm so thrilled and so honored to do so. So as we get ready to leave, let's remember what our King did. As our worship team plays and sings, let's celebrate the resurrection, because he, my friend, is King of Kings. He is Lord of Lords. Amen? Amen. Let's sing together.